Hi everyone, I am Ms. Sashriga and today's topic is anilkenol. Anilkenol overall it can be asked as 15 mark question and a separate topic of it which is the parts and interior of anilkenol can be asked as a 5 mark question. So let's see the synopsis of today's topic. Location and extent, relations, parts and interior, anal sphincters and then blood supply, nerve supply, lymphatic drainage and finally applied anatomy. Okay, let's now start. Anilkenol is a terminal part of the alimentary tract or GIT and the total length of the anilkenol is 3.8 cm or 38 mm. Then talking about the location and extent, it is located below the pelvic diaphragm in the perineum. In previous lectures you have got clear about the perineum. So in this diagram you can see this is the anterior perineum and this is the posterior perineum. So here this is the anilkenol. So this anilkenol, it is located in the posterior perineum, that is anal triangle of perineum, in between the right and left ischiorectal fossae. Coming to the extent of anilkenol, the anilkenol, it extends from the anorectal junction above to the anal orifice below. Here in this diagram, you can see it clearly. So this is the anorectal junction and this is the tip of the coccyx. And this is anus, also called anal orifice. So this anorectal junction, it is located just below and in front of the tip of the coccyx. And about the location of the anus, it is 4 cm below the tip of the coccyx. So coming to the relations of the anilkenol, anteriorly we have the perineal body in both males and females. But in addition to perineal body in males, we have urethra and bulb of penis. In case of females, anteriorly there will be vagina. So this is the perineal body. And coming to the posterior relations, just behind the anal canal, you can see the tip of coccyx and a ligament extending from the tip of coccyx to the anal canal, which is called the anococcygeal ligament or the anococcygeal raphe. So the tip of the coccyx and this anococcygeal raphe, they form the posterior relation of the anal canal. And about the lateral relation of anilkenol, in the previous diagram we have seen on either sides we have the fat filled space called the ischiorectal fossa or the ischioanal fossa. Then the anilkenol is surrounded by the sphincteric muscles, that is the inner involuntary and outer voluntary sphincters that keeps the lumen closed. So this is about the relations of anilkenol. And then coming to the most important heading, parts and interior of the anilkenol. So the anilkenol, it is divided into three parts, namely upper part, middle part and lower part by two transverse lines. One is pectinate line or watershed line of anilkenol, which is you can see here. And one more line will be the Hilton's line or the white line of Hilton. So these two transverse lines, namely the pectinate line and the Hilton's line, will divide the anilkenol into these three parts. So the part above the pectinate line or the upper 15 mm of the anilkenol is called the upper part of anilkenol. Then the middle 15 mm is the middle part of the anilkenol. It is also called as pectin. So the extent of middle part is, it extends from the pectinate line above to the Hilton's line below. So below the Hilton's line we have the lower part of the anilkenol, which is only about 8 mm and it is lined by skin. So the total length of the anilkenol will be 15 plus 15 plus 8, it is 38 mm or 3.8 cm. So here we know that it is divided into three parts by two transverse lines, namely pectinate line and Hilton's line. So the upper part of anal canal, which is above the pectinate line, it is also called as mucous part, and it is lined by simple columnar epithelium. Then the middle part, which is from pectinate line to the Hilton's line, it is also called as pectin or transitional zone, and it is lined by non-keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. And next is the lower part. It is located below the Hilton's line, and since it is covered by skin, it is obviously lined by keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. So this is about the parts of the anal canal. Now coming to interior of the anal canal. So the three important features of the upper part are namely anal columns, anal valves, anal sinuses. So this can be remembered by mnemonic CVS. So C for columns, V valves, and S sinuses. So about the anal columns, they are also called the columns of Morgagni. It is 6 to 10 longitudinal mucous folds. Here in this diagram you can see this is the anal columns. Then about the anal valves, the lower ends of the anal columns are connected with each other by transverse mucous folds called the anal valves. So the anal valves are nothing but they are the transverse mucous folds connecting the lower ends of the anal columns. So this position of anal valves, it also corresponds to the location of the pectinate line. Now the third important feature of the upper part is the anal sinuses. It is also labeled in the diagram, and it is located just above the anal valves. So we have some depressions called anal sinuses. The anal sinuses or depressions located just above the anal valves. And the importance of this anal sinuses is the anal glands open into this anal sinuses. So this is the anal sinuses above the anal valves. Okay. So next heading is the anal sphincters. So it is also an important heading. So you see this diagram, it is the rectum and this is the anal canal, and the blue color, it is the internal anal sphincter, and the green one is the external anal sphincter. So here we have to know the three basic difference between the two sphincters. Okay, the internal anal sphincter, it is made up of smooth muscle fibers. In previous lecture about the rectum, you would have learnt the inner circular smooth muscle of rectum. So that inner circular smooth muscle of rectum, when it continues downwards into the anal canal, it gets thickened to form the internal anal sphincter. So as it is made up of smooth muscle fibers, the internal anal sphincter, it is involuntary in nature. Next, you can see this internal anal sphincter, it is incomplete, that is, it does not enclose the entire length of the anal canal. It covers only up to the Hilton's line. So this internal anal sphincter, it is incomplete. Then talking about the external anal sphincter, this external anal sphincter, it is made up of skeletal muscles. So this external anal sphincter, it is voluntary in nature, and it is also complete, as it covers the entire length of the anal canal. Okay. So we have to remember that internal anal sphincter, it is involuntary, as it is formed by the inner smooth muscles of rectum, and it is also incomplete. It covers only up to the Hilton's line. Then about the innervation of the internal anal sphincter, it is supplied by the sympathetic nerves. Then about the external anal sphincter, it is voluntary as it is formed by skeletal muscle, and it is complete, and the innervation, it is supplied by the somatic nerves, and in specific inferior rectal nerve. So this diagram, it shows the inner smooth muscle of rectum. It continues downwards as internal anal sphincter, and we can see the external anal sphincter here. So in this diagram you can see the three parts of the external anal sphincter. From below upwards, subcutaneous part, which is just beneath the skin, and then the second one is the superficial part, and then deep part. So here these are the three parts of the external anal sphincter. Here we know that the external anal sphincter, it is made up of the skeletal muscles, but out of the three parts of the external anal sphincter, only the middle part, that is the superficial part, is made up of the skeletal muscle. It only has the bony attachments. So you can see in this diagram, this is the superficial part, which is the second part, with middle part of the external anal sphincter. So posteriorly, it is attached to the tip of the coccyx through anococcygeal raphe, and anteriorly it is attached to the perineal body. So here in this diagram, you can also see a muscular sling extending from this pubic bone, or the pubic symphysis, to the anorectal junction, namely the puborectal sling. It is actually a part of the levator ani muscle, and it is an important factor for maintaining the anorectal angle, which is important for defecation. So this is about the sphincters. Next is the arterial supply of anal canal. So in this diagram, you can see this is the pectinate line. So above the pectinate line, it is the upper anal canal, and below the pectinate line is the lower anal canal. So the upper anal canal, it is supplied by the branches of superior rectal artery. So this superior rectal artery, it is a continuation of the inferior mesenteric artery. And then the lower anal canal, it is supplied by the inferior rectal artery, and it is a branch of the internal pudendal artery. So this is the arterial supply. So next is the venous drainage of the anal canal. We know that the anal canal, it is a common site of portocaval anastomosis. So this is the pectinate line. Above the pectinate line, it is drained by the superior rectal vein, and below the pectinate line, it is drained by the inferior rectal vein. So this superior rectal vein continues as the inferior mesenteric vein, and it drains into the splenic vein. And then the inferior rectal vein, it drains into the internal pudendal vein. So the superior rectal vein is the portal tributary, and the inferior rectal vein is a systemic tributary. So moving on to the innervation, that is the nerve supply of anal canal. So the upper anal canal, it is supplied by the autonomic nerves. So it is obviously a pain insensitive zone. And the lower anal canal, it is supplied by the somatic nerves. And actually it is internal inferior rectal nerve, which is a branch of the pudendal nerve. So the below the pectinate line, the anal canal, it is pain sensitive zone, since it is supplied by the somatic nerves. Okay. So next will be the lymphatic drainage of anal canal. So above the pectinate line, the lymph drains into the internal iliac nodes through the pararectal nodes, and below the pectinate line, it drains into the superficial inguinal nodes. So this tabular column, it shows the difference between the upper and lower anal canal, that is above and below the pectinate line respectively. So first, when we see about the development, the upper anal canal, it is derived from the hindgut. The upper anal canal is the last derivative of the hindgut. And about the lower anal canal, it is derived from an embryonic structure called proctodium, which is ectodermal in origin. Okay, so the above the pectinate line, it is endodermal in origin. Below the pectinate line, it is ectodermal in origin. So next is the epithelial lining. And the upper anal canal, it is lined by simple columnar epithelium. And the lower anal canal, which is the middle part and lower part of anal canal, it is lined by stratified squamous epithelium. Then moving on to innervation, we have already discussed in previous slide. And then blood supply, we have discussed the upper and lower anal canal. They are supplied by the corresponding rectal vessels, which is superior and inferior rectal vessels respectively. Then the lymphatic drainage, we have seen. And one more difference, which is not actually shown in the Stalbert column, then about the type of the hemorrhoids. So above the pectinate line, the hemorrhoids, if it occurs, it is internal hemorrhoids. And if it occurs below the pectinate line, it is called as external hemorrhoids. So this is about the difference between the upper and lower anal canal. So this is the final heading of anal canal, which is applied anatomy. So three important applied anatomy are the hemorrhoids, which is also called piles, and then anal fissures, and the third one is the anal fistula or the fistula in ano. So in previous slide, we saw the two types of hemorrhoids. The two basic difference between the two types of hemorrhoids, that is the internal hemorrhoid, it occurs above the pectinate line, that is in upper anal canal, whereas the external hemorrhoid, it occurs below the pectinate line. Can you guess which hemorrhoid will be painful and why? Because we have discussed in previous slides about the nerve supply, no? So actually the external hemorrhoid, it occurs below the pectinate line. So the region which is it is supplied by the somatic nerves. So that will be the pain sensitive zone. So the external hemorrhoids is a very painful condition, whereas the internal hemorrhoid is painless because that is supplied by autonomic nerves. So this side it is normal, and here you can see the internal hemorrhoids and external hemorrhoids. Okay, next the second one, anal fissure. So in this condition there will be a rupture of anal valves. It occurs due to the passage of hard stools in patients suffering from constipation, and it is actually an extremely painful condition. The patient will have severe pain during this anal fissure. So the next is the anal fistula. So basically fistula, it is an abnormal communication between two areas or two spaces or cavities, or between one cavity and exterior. So already you might have studied about the tracheoesophageal fistula in respiratory system. So that means abnormal communication between the lumen of trachea and the lumen of esophagus. So similarly, when we talk about the anal fistula, it is a communication between the lumen of anal canal and the neighboring structure, namely ischioanal fossa. So this is about the applied anatomy. So that's it. This is the end of anal canal. I hope you have got clear about this topic. So thank you so much.